detail into the tool with which you can actually generate stress because there are some, like, you might be able to use your own. But I'll tell you the story from how we reached where we are today and what all things we did. So before starting, my name is Mitesh Sharma. I work at Kiwi. So we are basically building a social real-time game shows, like multiple game shows. You can find them in these places. So when we talk about the stress testing, we first need to understand, like, every system has their capacity limit. When you are running any production system, at some point of time, that production system will, like, come under the stress because of the traffic which is coming. And then it starts responding slow and showing errors. More like reacting in an unpredictable way, which we don't want. So stress-driven development helps us to keep check on their limit all the time. So if you are not doing stress-driven development, you are doing prayer-driven development, where you are praying that your system will never fail. So when we talk about, like, load on a system or stress on a system, we first need to understand how is our traffic coming. Like, we need to describe our traffic. Like in our case, because we are running a game show, all the traffic comes at exactly at single point. So that generates huge amount of stress, and because everyone want to enter the game show, they, like, trying to fetch all the information which is required to enter the game show, and they hit our server a lot. So which, like, similarly you can describe your own traffic, that what is your peak load, like at what time a lot of users come, is your system ready to handle those kind of load. So then, like, you need to understand the limits of the system, because without understanding limits, you won't be able to optimize your code. Then you need to understand, like, on different loads how the system is performing, so that you can identify bottlenecks into a system, because currently our production systems are so complex that it involves, like, multiple pipelines. Like, it has an application server, it has some Redis, databases, messaging queues. So understanding the bottleneck and then fixing the bottleneck is most critical part. So when we talk about scaling a system, it's not about just increasing the number of servers, it's about identifying the bottleneck and actually going and fixing that particular bottleneck so that your system is end-to-end ready to take the load. So, like, whenever we talk about, like, stress-driven development, like, we should need to understand how to start. What is our baseline? Like, let's say I have a server and I can easily handle 1,000 requests per second. Is it the right thing? Like, is it the max what I can achieve? So we first need to identify the endpoints on which our users can generate load on the system, or it can actually create stress on our system. Then once we identified our, like, baseline endpoints, then the second thing is, like, benchmarking results. When we talk about benchmarking results, we need to benchmark it with some baseline. Now, how to identify that baseline? So the first thing to go set up a empty server, more like a, so let's say you are running a Node.js server with your own, like, set of code. So the simplest thing you can do is have an empty Node.js server with a simple endpoint. It does nothing, it just takes a request, return a response, simple OK response. Now with this, you can start generating load on that system with a given set of system configurations, and you can identify your baseline, that a empty Node.js server which has a single REST API, it returns OK, can maybe generate, like, 20,000 requests per second. So that will give you a kind of baseline on which you can then start thinking that, okay, now my server, which is doing some task, how it is performing. So then the next step, like, obviously, is to start generating load on your server and then measure it in terms of baseline. That gives you an idea that, okay, from the baseline, how far I am. Like, can I even reach the baseline? Like, so that gives us a more like mental model in which we can work on. So with this, we can find bottlenecks, we can optimize our code, we can test again, and then we can optimize. So this is a whole, like, cycle which we can do. So to give you a, like, bigger picture, so this is more like a final version which we want to achieve every time. So we never want to generate load on our production system, because at the same time, even users are making requests on the production system. So we make an exact replica of production. So we know, like, how our production workload, like, perform when we are running our test workload. So the configuration of systems need to be same. Second is, we need to simulate, like, we need to have clients, lot of clients who can actually go and generate similar kind of load. So let's say you are having, like, an app, maybe iOS or Android app. So you need to simulate the similar kind of behavior and have similar, like, same number of apps you can generate root, or maybe more like a simulation of them. The third thing which is very critical is plan your test. Now, when we say plan your test, it becomes critical because you need to have modulate the user behavior. Like one of the things which we does is you can have a proxy and like play through your app and then identify how the app is actually performing with the help of proxy. So we use Charles proxy. What it does is when we play, we mock a user behavior, it exactly gives us how our APIs are performing, like what is the first API, what is the second API, so that we can exactly simulate and make our own test plan. The fourth step is start the test. So we try to simulate the test at the same time on multiple devices. What it does, it actually try to emulate the production environment with like multiple clients sending the request at the same time and generating stress on our server. So we know how our server is actually performing at different varying load. And then finally, watch for results. So in our case, we use new learning. We also have some internal dashboard which actually help us identify how many requests we are serving, what is the latency, like which user is actually behaving, like what is the max latency. So before this development methodology, we were actually even sending requests, taking 60 seconds to actually return, giving a response to the user, and which is not an ideal behavior for end user. So why we did it? So once upon a time, we are just a startup, we keep developing features, there were so many features and we were very happy. We were like, okay, our app is ready, now we want to see scale. We want to experience what happens when scale comes. And the unique part in our case is we send a notification to all of our users and everyone comes at the same time. So even though in our past we developed a lot of games and all, so there we worked with millions of users. In this case, even with less number of users, our system app started responding slow. All the latency of each user entering game show was very high. They were complaining that we are not able to enter the game show. And then we were we don't even know how many users we can handle. So the first thing which we decided is to remove the bottlenecks, first optimize the most critical APIs so that we can give user that initial amount, initial experience to its best what we can achieve. So the next question is how we did it. So it's not that on the one day we started and we reached to a final stage where we are generating load on the system and now our system is performing in a super awesome way. We went into stages, so I'll gradually tell it as a story, how we started and all. So first thing, when we started, it is our first request. We wanted to optimize so that we can handle huge number of first requests, because everyone will make an initial request to our server, which is more like a diff request, where the user wants to get their data with which it knows the initial information to enter a game show. Then we thought, okay, let's try to create stress on our server. So we use JMeter to actually, JMeter is a tool which is Apache JMeter, is open source, you can go and use it. So we used it and hit our API 1,000 times at the same time. And when we started from our local system. So we had a developer had a laptop, he used JMeter, he started generating load, then he went to New Relic, saw the logs, and then identified, oh, it's actually happening that when we have huge amount of users coming at the same time, our system is not performing as it is. Even the single response time can reach to 60 seconds or more when a lot of people come at the same time. So then we actually went inside, added logs, added timestamps, and then identified what is the critical piece, what is the critical section which is actually taking the most time. And then we tried to make part of things asynchronous, optimize the code, identify what are the things which we needed, and then we rerun the same test again. Now, this thing worked fine, for a starter, this thing is good enough. We are able to generate some amount of load, we are able to get a request. But we cannot achieve everything with this setup. So the limitation is, one is there is no homogeneous test environment. Everyone is running on their own laptop, every laptop is different. Second is, so a single instance or single machine cannot generate infinite amount of load. Every system has their own capabilities. And when you start generating, when you start making infinite requests from a system, it is going to generate it with time because of the limitation of the instance. So another thing is sharing test code in itself is hard because like I have my own stress test code, some other developer have their own stress test code, he want my client send him on Gmail or maybe share it using Dropbox or somewhere. So eventually there was no standardization. Plus the coordination is hard because even at such a critical time, all your major workforce like work to just try to identify bottlenecks and fix on it. So multiple people started and load at the same time and the final result is not accurate. So the standardization is very important and coordination is very important. Plus it is a very manual process. I need to go actually run the test and tell everyone that okay, I am running the code. So automation is also another thing which we need. So obviously like we thought let's move all the steps at a single place. So we moved it to a version control system which is like in our case GitLab, we are using GitLab. Then instead of having our own local instance, we moved to a single stress test server. So we said this is our server from where we are going to generate code. And everybody in the company can go to the same server and start generating code. It's good, like now we are at a much better place. Everyone knows where the script, like load generating scripts are. Everyone can go there and generate code. It was like really good because other developers who are new to this field, they can go and start generating code. With this, we achieved a lot of stuff. Like we came to a place where all the tested code is standardized. But the problem is, again, what happened? Like one day I went and I started generating code. At the same time, there was another developer who again went to the same machine and started generating code. So the problem is coordination is still a problem because multiple people can come and start generating code on the single system. So you need to communicate, you need to post on Slack that okay, yeah, I'm going to start the test. No one else should start the test. Again, like there is no automation because I need to go SSH to a stress test server and generate code from there. And again, we are limited by stress test instance capabilities. So like now, we are easily able to identify the problem. So automation is the biggest problem. If we automate this thing and we tell everyone at a single place that okay, now stress test is started, don't go and start it again. So if they are able to identify and go at one place, from there they can start it. And even anyone have the capability to start it, then it will be like great. So we moved to a version 3 where we actually use Jenkins for doing the same thing. So now we have a stress test instance, we actually configured it so that Jenkins can talk to it. Now what Jenkins does, it clones stress test code on that particular instance and run test from there. Now we are like in a good state, like when everyone can go and start load testing from Jenkins. So even testers were able to do this. So now, because eventually our aim is like developers want to empower other people who can go and do all those kind of things. So now the only problem which stays with us is we can only generate limited amount of load on our like simulated production environment. But that limited amount of load is not good enough. We want to reach to the end limits of our system so we know at any point of time how much traffic we can handle. So for that, we knew that okay, now we need to handle the problem where we can instantiate many instances while giving like cost in check. Because another problem is, let's say developer comes, he spawns 100 instances. Like, okay, today I am going to generate load from 100 instances. I'm going to generate infinite load. So like everyone will be proud that okay, I generated most load. And like I know our system works on such a load. So for this, like we use Terraform. It's very easy to use. It's an infrastructure as a code. It's a tool which provides infrastructure as a code. But it's not limited to infrastructure as a code. You can even have like pass as code or SaaS as code. Even you can configure your Bitbucket or JetLab, those kind of things. It's supported by many cloud providers. It's written in it uses Hashicorp configuration language. You can even use JSON, but I find it easier to use. So it's written in Go. And for all our stress test client instances, we use AWS EC2 instance. So I'm assuming everyone is aware of AWS EC2. So let's go deep into Terraform and understand how it works. Because without understanding Terraform, it's really difficult to directly go and create instances and all those kind of things. So first thing, Terraform currently supports more than 70 providers, which are officially documented on their website. But community support is like more than 100. And plus you can write your own provider if you want. If you have your own custom setup where you want to use Terraform, you can write your own provider. Because they have the core model and then there are multiple providers. So, like before going to talk about commands, I'll directly go and show you in the code. So in this case, what I have done, like I have used modules. So I'll go into one of the module. So let's say I went into a VPC module. So what this module does is this module generate a complete network for me. Now with this module, I will generate a VPC, a public subnet, security group. I'll give access to my like whatever access, like security wise, network ACL wise, routing table wise, I'll like set up everything. So whenever we want to write a module, or module in itself is Terraform code. So whenever we want to write our own Terraform code, we need to first specify what provider we want to use. So that when we are actually running our code, it knows that okay, these are the like API which you want to use. It can download any dependency. So in case of providing AWS, it's going to download AWS CLI, which internally make all the AWS API calls. Now we define what resources we want and all the required information regarding the resource. So when we write the complete Terraform module, Terraform code, what it does is internally create a dependency graph. With this dependency graph, it gradually goes and identify what task I can do in parallel and what task I can do sequentially and start provisioning your infrastructure. In our case, what it does, it provision a like a networking layer, and inside that we are going to generate like instantiate resources, like instances. So I directly go and like simply run Terraform in it. What it does, in this case, it already has AWS CLI, otherwise it would have downloaded. Now other small commands are validated. So it will validate your code, and this point of time it will tell, is there any like syntax error you have done. Now we have a code, right? But we want to understand, if we directly run it on our production system, the problem is we don't know what is going to happen. We don't have any kind of visualization. So it gives a command plan. With this, we can exactly see what is the plan, like what is, it is more like a real world mapping of what is going to happen on the production system. So now in this case, it has provided some IP addresses, because I already told him that your CID and CID block IP addresses 10.1.0.16. But there are so many fields which are computed, because as of now, at this point of time, it doesn't know what their value is going to be. We might provide its value from some other resource, or it auto-computed based on its default configuration. So all these information will be computed when we actually apply it. Before that, just to show you, I'll show you the command graph, Terraform graph. So what it does, it provided us a complete dependency graph. In this format, it's not very human readable, but what you can do is copy this and post it to any graph visualization tool. It will actually show you the graph. In this case, it's very complex thing. Everything is in parallel. Most of the things are in parallel, which don't have dependency. So what it does, in itself, it identifies dependencies based on the, like, if you use any resource argument in some other resource, or you can also define your own dependency with the help of, like, there's syntax, like, there's a depends on with which you can define the dependency. So what I will do is I'll apply it on my my own AWS account. So it will generate a VPC instance. Meanwhile, we save, let's go on the slides, because it's going to take some time. Yeah, so I already talked about init. It is to create your workspace where you are going to actually work and run all the commands. Then validate will help you validate your code. Plan will give you an exact execution plan which is going to run on your production system. Apply will actually apply it. Then in every Terraform code, we are going to define some variables, which are more like dynamic variables, which we can inject either from like while running or to environment variable or to our own code, so that the main code and variables are separated out. Then we can also define our outputs, because in some cases we might take some output from one of the part of the code and use it in some other part of it. So in my case, I have multiple modules. So for one module, I have only networking. It provides all the networking details, which can be used by instances, and then I use it. And destroy is to destroy the complete Terraform infrastructure. They also, so how they manage, they are like, how Terraform is different from other like providers, you can also provision infrastructure using Ansible. But Terraform keeps state. So its state is a real-world mapping of how your infrastructure looks. So if you have a state file, you can exactly see, like, you can tell how my infrastructure is provisioned on, like, on actual AWS server. By default, store the state locally. So in our case, we are storing state locally in Jenkins using the job number. So that way, it is unique. But you can, because the problem is, it also contains sensitive information. Like, let's say I'm using an IAM like resource and creating a user ID, it will keep the state file IAM access key and secret, which is like you don't want that. So you can use a remote backend which stores this information secretly. So one of the things like which you can use for free is S3 plus DynamoDB. So DynamoDB is used for locking, so that when multiple people run, it prevents security. And then state, when another like good secure part is when we are running it locally, it takes the like complete state from the back like backend and store it in memory. It doesn't store it in hard disk so that anyone can come and access. Modules are more like reusability of the code. So in our case, like I have a network module and I have an instance module. So now if anyone want to work on for creating a complete network layer, they can use my module. They can go take the module and directly use it. Like we don't, so it helps in reusability. You can, so there are many modules which are already there. So there is a Terraform registry where there are already pre-existing modules. You can directly go use it, but there are lot more on GitHub. You can like directly pull them from there. And you can specify the input parameters of the module and use the parameter from module to another module. So let's come to our final version. We automated everything with Jenkins. So now there is a single place from where we go, we run our test case. Terraform is useful for generating code. In our case, like everything is not tested using JMeter because everything is not in REST API. There are some code which is using WebSockets. So we use our custom code, but we use a command named AT. What it does, it runs some specific script at a particular time. You can go and our tested code is a single repository which is resident controlled. So we know like if something is failing on the code side, we know who did it. And now it is part of our release process. So before every release, QA's run it. So at that before release, we know, okay, now our critical API are failing. And with time, we are actually extending it to all the APIs. We are actually generating load with the exact same scenario which happens in production. So in our case, tools we used are Jenkins, Terraform, AT, Linux command, JMeter, custom scripts, and custom client apps like its own, our own app with third-party API which we are using. And we have internal dashboard to identify how much time it takes. We use New Relic to see latency, load, and all those things. I think this is important because these are the learnings which we got during the complete this process. One is in Terraform, always do plan before apply. Because if you apply, you don't even know what you did. Like, code can fail and all those things you will be able to identify at the plan stage. And once you are done, destroy because you want to save cost. Like in our case, we initially started with on-demand instances, and that instance is still running. We are spending a lot of money, even though we are not using the particular. So, how Terraform is different from, like, if you know about CloudFormation, they do both same task, CloudFormation for AWS, Terraform is more generic. What it does is Terraform took the approach where it keeps states. So, let's say your Terraform code fails, maybe because, like, AWS limited, which happened with us. Like we wanted to spawn 400 instances once. Now we don't have that much of an element. Like we don't even know why we were running. And we suddenly saw everything fail. So at that point of time, go fix the problem or destroy whatever infrastructure you have created because it keeps, like it don't go and roll back everything. Like test on stage before production, like just test locally or like somewhere so that you are sure your code is working as expected. Jenkins is the only one who will apply. Because we don't want anyone to go create infrastructure for us. One easy way is to have your own access key which has permission to run this code and put it on Jenkins or like some way by environment variable or some other way. And don't let anyone else have those kind of permissions. Do small incremental changes because you don't want like to write a lot of code and then realize there is no turning back. So like I told you, use on-demand instances, they are costly. So we move to spot instance, but they are very cheap, like they are like 1/5 of the cost and at time they are much cheaper than that. And Yeah, so just to give you an idea, use Jenkins, so we can provide custom scripts, like which can be downloaded on the instance. You can provide time, like after which you want to run your code, because you might want developer or tester to be ready, so that they can go to particular tools and like see. We can use old instances that are created from some other like Jenkins jobs. You can destroy them, like because once we are done, we want to destroy it. So for now, we may keep it manual, so that like tester or developer have the capability that they want to go and fetch some information from like those clients. And then these are custom data parameters, which extra data we want to use on our server. So we send all these information to our final tester and set it up with our like planning. And then after like specified time, we start running them. So in case of JMeter, we use their own internal client server model, but for our own custom scripts, we have our own custom code which is written. So this is just a sample of like instances. In this case, it's only 15, but we at times run 400, 200, depending on like how much we want to generate. And yeah, this is an example of neural link dashboard where we are actually seeing like what is the threshold. So yeah, I think let's go back to our Terraform code. Sorry. So it asked me, so every time it runs, it asks for apply, but you can force it. So when we are running it on Jenkins, we don't want anyone to actually go and manually type yes and all the information. So we forced it. So every time like code is run, it is actually forced. And one of the reasons for that, because we know that this code is performing as expected. So now what it will does is we'll create these things and we can actually go and see it on our AWS. Currently, still generating. So I created a VPC internet gateway because I want public subnet, routing table, and all those things. So, yeah, it takes some time. Yeah, so in this case, one is on demand instance, one is spot instance. So if you go and see spot request, we already generated a spot request. So in case of spot, so we already requested a spot instance, which we got. And we provided the maximum price, same as that of on-demand price. So in worst case, like we get the spot that we want, because now pricing is dynamic, it does not only handle the cost. So yeah, once it is done, like still waiting for the test consent to reply. Now I can show you the state file. It has so it is more like a replica of real world, like whatever we are actually seeing. And once I am done, I can destroy it. So everything is automated in this case. So you can go to this GitHub link and dig the code and try it yourself. It already have like modules and all, so you can reuse it. Slides are available at this slideshare link. So yeah, if you have anything, like, I have to, anyone have any questions? Just now we moved to a server client model. Before that we were running like directly copying code on all the instances and running like from there. Because we were not seeing the JMeter response, we were initially seeing neural link response, which is actually the vendor dashboard. But now, to get better understanding, we started doing it on from like Jenkins machine itself, who actually connect to all the instances and run a client there, and so that we get the data. So that is currently transitioning to a better system, where we have like if something fails, we can see it at a single place.
So the Terraform created two instances, right? So what are they doing actually?
Okay, so what happens is when we are running Terraform, the Jenkins instance SSH key get copied on all the machines. Now that instance has actual SSH access on all the machines. It goes there, you SSH, copies file, because we have given generic URLs, more like you can use your own Dropbox URL or some other S3 URL. It downloads that file from there. The complete setup which we already done in a script, like you can use Ansible or you can even use Terraform like provisioning everything. It does a complete setup. Now, after like with the help of KT2, we actually go and run everything after like tea time. And then like actual stress. You got what you wanted.
So you compare this with the cloud formation of AWS.
Yes.
Can you please elaborate more?
Okay, so I haven't used cloud formation because you know, I felt I started with Terraform, it's super easy to use. Yeah. But the major difference which I read about is Terraform keeps, so when if something fails on cloud formation, it holds back. It goes to a zero state. But what Terraform does, it keeps the state where it is. So you need to actually go fix that code and apply it. And it keeps a real world copy. So even if you go on your AWS client and do something like you go and delete half of the instances. And then the next time you run the apply, it try to map both the things. Or like if you remove something from the code, because Terraform code is also version controlled. So that way. But yeah, I don't have like in-depth detail about cloud formation. But yeah, it's used for provisioning infrastructure on AWS. Yeah, I think time's up. If anyone have any question, I think I have Pradeep, like he's my colleague. So you can ask him or me, like any question. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Mitesh. DevOps track here, but if you are interested in any lightning talks or any other tracks, you can go to main auditorium. You can propose your lightning talk over there, and this is opportunity you can grab it. Thanks all for coming. Enjoy.